All right, we are back with another episode of the Daily Grossi. I am Chops. This is my first time hosting the Daily Grossi. We have some staff. You know, Tony, it's that time of year. People on vacation. It's a snowstorm outside in Cleveland. We have Tony Grossi with us, the general of the Hundred Years' War. Tony, how are we doing today? How are we feeling?
Chops, the Browns are probably going to go through four quarterbacks very soon. You are our fourth host this year of the Daily Grossi. So we beat them to the punch by a few days.
And the Daily Grossi is undefeated, unlike the Browns, who are 7-4 right now.
Yeah. Well, they're having a good year. We're doing a little better.
There we go. Let's get right into it. So the Browns are in Los Angeles right now. We got a lot of injury updates yesterday, especially on defense. Where do things stand with Myles Garrett, Denzel Ward, Anthony Walker? Because that's a lot of your defense right there, kind of banged up and unsure of right now.
Yeah, it was a pretty encouraging report yesterday from Coach Kevin Stefanski. But really, the next checkpoint is tomorrow's practice to see if any of these guys will be even limited or will they be held out. And if that happens, it doesn't mean they won't play on Sunday against the Rams. But I think the next point is to see if any of them are able to start the practice week on the field. And we won't know till tomorrow, but certainly it was encouraging that Myles Garrett, coach said he expects him to be ready for Sunday. The same thing with a couple of the other guys, Amari Cooper, who did not fracture any ribs, but, you know, sore ribs for a receiver are tough to play with. You're stretching out all that. Big question also is whether Denzel Ward will be able to pick up this week. He missed the game in Denver, and his absence was sorely felt.
Did you anticipate Denzel Ward's absence being that big of a – obviously, he's a very good player. We know this. But, Tony, it seemed to be a bigger issue than anybody anticipated, I think.
Yeah, it put him up against Courtland Sutton in that first drive, and there were two big plays there, a DPI and then a 31-yard reception by Sutton, where he cleanly beat Newsom right at the line of scrimmage. No, I didn't expect it would be that severe because, you know, the Broncos have been running the ball more, but that drive was so important because it gave them a 7-0 lead, and it just threw the Browns game plan, I thought, under the carpet there. I didn't expect it to be that much of an impact, but it certainly was.
And then you brought up Myles Garrett. They got encouraging news. Tony, if he's able to play, there's a chance he's not going to be 100%. Do you have confidence in the rest of the D-line to maybe pick up a 80% Myles Garrett rather than, you know, a fully – no one's 100% this time of the year, obviously. Yeah. But he was clearly not himself in that Broncos game for a lot of it.
Yeah, I think now, you know, Jim Schwartz is able to plan for a less than 100% Myles Garrett, whereas when it happens during a game, I mean, there's so much going on. It's tough to adjust your superstar pass rusher being less than 100%. Obviously, Za'Darius Smith has to pick it up. Obo Okonkwo, and we saw more of Alex Wright in the Denver game. I think being able to practice with that in mind, that you're going to have Garrett at less than 100%, will make a difference in this game against the Rams.
Gotcha. Tony, before we continue, let's hear from our friends at BetMGM.
Yeah, you know, now you can enjoy all your favorite sports like never before at BetMGM. Sign up, use the code GROSSI, and you'll receive up to $1,500 back in bonus bets if you don't win your first bet. When you register with BetMGM, you'll get instant access to a variety of parlay selection features, player props, and the very best daily promotions in the business. With BetMGM at your fingertips, every play and every game matter more than ever. Must be 21 and up and present in Ohio. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER in partnership with MGM Northfield Park.
Amazing. So, Tony, we got a lot of encouraging defensive injury updates, I would say. And like you said, Amari Cooper, the quarterback situation. DTR is in concussion protocol. There's a lot of uncertainty there. Joe Flacco is still currently on the practice squad as we record this. Where do you see this going? Is it going to be Flacco time for the Browns on Sunday?
You know, I think so, Chop. The coach won't commit to that early in the week. I can't remember since this super awareness of the concussion and brain injuries and all that, and the clampdown on this protocol. I can't remember ever a player who suffered a concussion in a Sunday game playing in the very next game. It may have happened. I just can't think of it. And you're talking about a quarterback, and you're also talking about a young quarterback who's struggling with his role, his enormous role he's been placed into. So my feeling is that the coach will make a determination early in the week. They won't announce it necessarily to the public, but I think they have to feel that they have to get Flacco ready. P.J. Walker has, you know, they probably squeezed as much as they can out of him, and I think they know that. And it's good to have him in reserve, but Flacco's an unknown quantity to the opponent at this stage. He's fresh, physically fresh. He didn't end his last season beaten down like a lot of 37-year-old quarterbacks. So I think we'll see this as an opportunity to get a fresh, experienced, strong-armed, cold as ice quarterback on the field. So I do expect them, Chops, to get Flacco ready.
Before we go into the Flacco thing a little bit, you wrote last night that you thought the emotions of the Steeler game really were on DTR. And you could tell he was crying after the game. Mm-hmm. Is this just too much to put on a young kid who was a fifth-round pick who, coming into the season, Tony, like, you always expect that you're going to have to play, but, like, let's be honest. He did not think that he'd have a playoff run on his shoulders. It seems like a lot. And it seems like maybe that's why you need to go to a veteran like a Flacco.
You know, no doubt. Chops, I asked Kevin Stefanski that yesterday. You know, are you guys, why do you trust him with this enormous responsibility? You know, it's not like it's October and you're trying to develop a guy when you have the chance. It was an emotional week last week for DTR. And then you go to Denver where, man, it's tough to win for a veteran quarterback to at least take the Browns there and win. And then you're down 14-0 in the first quarter, trying to win on the road. So, yeah, I do think they're expecting too much out of DTR. And he did fine. He didn't turn the ball over for the first time in his three games. But that's why you go out and get a guy like Flacco. And really, again, I can't emphasize enough. He's not a beaten down old, you know, quarterback who's been IR'd. He's always been very durable. He's always been very healthy. And I think he's seen it all. And I think the offense, too, needs a stabilizing figure back there, you know. Mm-hmm. And you could just see some of the body language out there among the receivers during the game in Denver. I mean, the passes just not were what they needed to be all the time.
Yeah, and so that brings us to Flacco. And I think football-wise, what do you think would be the biggest adjustment for the rest of the team? You mentioned the receivers, but also the offensive line would have to adjust to a non-mobile quarterback, which, you know, P.J. Walker, DTR, Deshaun, varying levels of mobility, but they could all kind of move. Joe Flacco, not going to be the case.
Yeah, those designed runs or expecting scramble, the scramble drills will be thrown aside if Flacco goes in there. He avoids sacks by just throwing the ball away, like a pocket passer does. So yeah, I think the offensive line, that's another reason why you almost have to make the decision as soon as you can to get the offensive line in the mind of, you know, you got a different guy back there now, and he's going to stay in the pocket. I think you know, Flacco's played 15 seasons. He's not really been a sack machine in those years. He's been immobile since he came into the league, and he just knows how to distribute the ball and get rid of it to avoid sacks rather than using his legs.
Yeah, no, 100%. So, Tony, we mentioned to start this episode, the Browns are in L.A. currently. It seems like before the season when they planned this, hey, trip after Denver going to L.A. for the week, it was going to be a team bonding type thing. A lot has changed. Deshaun Watson is in L.A. because he just had surgery in L.A. Guys are getting hurt. The Browns don't have their facility. How do you think this is going to kind of go? And do you think Stefanski's still using this as a team bonding type thing?
Well, you know, Kevin personally requested to the league, appealed to the league, that we wouldn't mind being scheduled back to back on the West Coast. You know, teams can make their requests, mm-hmm. and they're not always honored, but they did honor this. So from the very start, he wanted this. And yeah, I think way back in May or even before that, when he was plotting this whole season out, he considered this another opportunity for the team to bond together. Now, the developments of this season have been nothing anyone could have planned. And as you mentioned, I mean, guys needing rehab on the road as they're preparing to recover from the past game. I think it throws some of those plans out the window. But then again, just being together away from home, even in this setting where you're in the midst of a playoff chase, I think he feels that's a positive experience rather than flying all the way back home from Denver like I did, making a long day of travel and then having to go all the way back. So I think in the long run, it'll prove to be the right decision, but it may not have gone exactly as he planned in May.
Do you see a benefit of it just kind of worked out that Deshaun Watson, if they do go to Flacco this week, and like you said, having the Wednesday, they've had success, Tony, when the quarterback has been able to go Wednesday to Friday and practice and then play. Do you see an added benefit of Deshaun's going to be in those rooms talking to them? So he's going to be able to talk to Joe and be kind of a sponge of anything he needs to know about Kevin's offense.
Yeah, absolutely. That would be a benefit. I mean, think about it. On top of everything we've said about DTR, he's the starter and, you know, he's needing the help of the other guys.
Yeah.
They haven't even been in there like Deshaun has been but Flacco's been there and done that, you know, even though this is a new environment for him. Yeah. I think it worked out that Deshaun had his surgery out in LA and is able to be out there, at this critical time. It is a critical time in this season, especially with the adjusting to possibly a fourth quarterback. So that was a benefit, and I think it's going to work out. I am actually excited to see what kind of game Flacco still has left. I think it'll be an improvement over what we've seen in the last couple of games.
Well, you, Tony, we know Stefanski likes to throw the ball.
Yeah.
If you're starting Flacco, are we going to see him fully go with, you know, and air it out?
Yeah. Chops, I think he always attempts to do that early to gain a lead.
Yeah.
And I think he'd be a lot more confident and comfortable mm-hmm. with Flacco as the trigger man, you know, based on what they're seeing. We're not seeing what game Flacco is, but obviously he had enough for them to bring him in here. So, I think he'll be aggressive to get a lead. He always is. Mm-hmm. The question is, you know, what happens when you don't? And we saw what happened in Denver. It the game plan goes out the window. But, yeah, I think he'd like to get that 14-0 lead and then just ride his running game as far as it could take him. But with Flacco, I think they got a better chance of doing that.
Definitely, definitely. Well, it's going to be an interesting week, Tony. Injury reports are going to be coming out at 6 p.m. Eastern. It's going to be a different type of schedule, but you'll be out on the West Coast. I'll actually be out on the West Coast, so it's going to be a fun time. And anything else to add before we wrap up this episode of the Daily Grossi?
Well, we'll get into talking about the Rams a little more later in the week, but I'm telling you, this game in May, when we saw the schedule, everyone checked it off as, okay, there's one there they steal. The Rams, much like Denver, are improved over what everyone expected.
Are you, before we get out of here, are you considering this a must-win, Tony, just looking at the schedule? Because I don't know if a lot of Browns fans right now are doing the playoff thing, Tony, where you're looking at who the Steelers are playing, who the Colts are playing. Yeah. You probably got to get to 10. Are you looking at this 10 wins? That is, are you looking at it as this is you got to get this one?
Well, I wouldn't call it must win, but if you don't win this one, the others become must wins, you know?
Yeah.
So you got to take them when you can. And, you know, everyone said, well, if we split on these two road games, we're good. Well, if you could have picked your split, you would have beaten the AFC team. Because that's what's going to factor in now. I think the division race is over for the Browns. And now you're looking at wild cards and tiebreakers. So yeah, it's not must win, but you don't want to make the last five must win. So you win this, you get a little bit of a breathing room.
Definitely, definitely. Well, Tony, thank you so much. It was great doing this with you. Until tomorrow, we'll see you for another episode of the Daily Grossi.
All right, Chop. See you then.